This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome to Phoenix Rising Radio. Now is the time to lift your mind higher. Now is the time to rise above. I am your host, Phoenix, and welcome to tonight's broadcast.
Fifth, 2018. Hope you're doing well. Oh man, we are running out of month here. Less than 7 days left in this month. Hope you're enjoying autumn. The equinox was this Saturday that we talked about, and full moon yesterday, last night. So quite an interesting time. A lot of crazy stuff going on. I have NeSe is joining me here this evening also. He's on the line. NeSe, are you on the line there, man? Hello, NeSe. Huh. Weird. I show him on the studio here, but he is not responding. Perhaps there's a problem. NeSe, if you can hear this or anyone hears this that's in contact. NeSe, you there?
I'm here.
Okay, there you go. Technical difficulties there, I see. How's it going?
It's going really well, but you know these apps and the computer world where they're like, oh, we need to do another update for one reason or another, and then it's challenging enough, I can imagine, for those that are sighted, but then you throw in the fact that you can't see, and they make little rearrangements of the buttons and stuff, and if you swipe a little bit to the left or up too much, then you totally select something different than what you expected. So it is fun as can be, but it's just, you know, it's such a frustrating fact that they're kind of tweaking it all the time. And that adage or that cliche, you know, if it's not broke, don't fix it.
Yeah, so true. And they're constantly messing with it. Skype's a big one, man. Everybody complains, especially in broadcasting, about the Skype updates because it messes with everything. I mean, they'll do, hey, you have a Skype update. Like, oh, God, please, no. And you click on the thing and everything changes and all your presets and everything are gone. And whenever you're broadcasting, your presets are a big deal. I mean, I don't want to get into it, but yeah, I understand. I feel your pain, feel your sorrow, because I deal with it all the time myself, and I know our listeners do too. You know, speaking of dealing with stuff, there's a lot of crazy things going on in the world, and we're going to get to a lot of that this evening. I wanted to touch upon something this evening. We're going to talk about a lot of different things, current events, etc. No real Q updates per se right now going on, but we will talk a little bit about the situation of the deep state and where we're standing with Q. Because as you know, if you're listening, this is the only station on or program on TFR where you can get Q updates right here on Phoenix Rising Radio on TFR. But the circus, this absolute insane circus that's going on in Washington, D.C. Is crazy. We're going to talk a little bit about that and some of the new twist on the Brett Kavanaugh for Supreme Court justice. But also, I'm going to talk tonight about psychological operations in the media. And we're going to get into that topic a little bit. And the question I pose to all of our listeners is, are you a victim of PsyOps through the media? And I will tell you right now, you don't have to answer that. The answer is yes. We all are, myself included, to a certain extent, of psychological operations put forward by the media. And what we're going to talk a little bit about this evening, in a while, is the triggers, what you can do to identify if you are being adversely affected or controlled by media psyops. And, you know, a lot of people think media psyops, you know, they're like CNN or ABC or Fox News or whatever, the big ones, right? Not necessarily so. It can be some of the smaller outlets. It can be some of the bloggers. It can be alternative media. Because what will happen is you'll have some of the alternative media, they will be influenced by psychological operations also and do the Mockingbird thing. You know, NeSe, you and I did a program one night on the Mockingbird media and the Project Mockingbird of the CIA. And the entire, just the very name of Mockingbird tells it all. Because, you know, the real power of the psychological operations in the media by via Project Mockingbird and what it's grown into through the advent of the internet and social media, Twitter, etc., is the power in it isn't core in the actual source. Say let's say CNN puts out a story that's totally fed to them by the 4 a.m. talking points of the CIA. Okay, so the story goes out. Everybody has it. Now, they start saying this. They impanel a panel of specialists or whatever who talk about this, and they put that thought form out there. Yeah, that's powerful, you know, because people watch this. But the true power in that, and this, thus the reason Mockingbird, is because people begin to repeat it like a mockingbird, because that's what a mockingbird does. A mockingbird hears a sound and mocks that sound, thus Mockingbird. And so what happens, you have people who see these things, and then they repeat them. And then you get the effect of the whisper down the alley thing, and this thing spreads all over the internet. It spreads all over work, through families. Oh, like, oh my God, didn't you hear? Oh, I saw on CNN this, this, and this. And the next thing you know, someone's talking to someone. Oh my God, did you hear? I heard from John down at work, this, this, and this. And it's this echo chamber of the mockingbirds throughout all of society and social media, which therein is the power of this. And we're going to discuss a little bit of that. But anyway, what's your major observations of what's going on, and how was your solstice, or not solstice, but the equinox and full moon, NeSe?
Well, interesting enough, since you did bring it up, as most of the listeners know, that I'm kind of a little fanatic about making sure I am aware of the full moon and the new moons and the equinoxes and the solstice. And if you remember this summer, before I went to my annual summer event, that I calculated that the equinox occurred the first week of June. And I'm not going by the calendar. I'm going by the actual calculating sunrise and sunset. And from the calculations, I want to say off the top of my head, it was either the 7th, 8th, or 9th of June that was the longest day. So by that calculation, we can predict, because of the common or the general cycle of the Earth and the Moon, is that in another 72 days, then it's going to be the next quarter or the next part of the cycle, which is fall. And in the fall, we have the equinox, which is equal day and equal night. So predicted by when the solstice occurred at the beginning of the month, so should the equinox occur at the beginning of the month of September. However, the calendar states or denotes that the equinox occurs on the 22nd of September, and it is now well past, well, not well past, but it is past the 22nd of September. And if you were to go to the all-intelligent Siri on my Apple phone, and I apologize for having to go to that whore, but if you ask Siri, when is sunrise and when is sunset, you will find out that it is either the equinox at sunset tonight or at sunrise tomorrow, because the equinox would be equal day and equal night, and so it would be in the cusp of the two. But ironically enough, that the equinox is occurring today, it also aligns up with the full moon. Now, I don't know if the rest of the audience can extrapolate that coincidence or synchronicity, but it takes a lot for the alignments of heavenly bodies to make such synchronizations. And as I have mentioned many, many times before, that when we are consciously aware of the cycles, then we are able to attune into them and kind of, in a sense, ride the wave of them. So if you are looking for a point to declare 0 point, your starting point, if you're depressed enough, if you're down enough, if you're low enough, or even if you want to start a new project or goal or dream, today is an incredible day to do that, because you will be in synchronicity with the equinox, in balance, or the 0 point. So from this point on, from this moment of the cycle, you can now say, I am no longer going to eat sugar, or I am no longer going to smoke cigarettes, or I am no longer going to be abusive, or whatever it may be. Or you, like I said, you're starting a task or whatever. You know, I am starting at sunrise tomorrow my equinox fast, where I will be fasting for 4 days. And that's what I usually do on the equinoxes and the solstices. And after that, I'm really seriously considering becoming a vegetarian again.
Well, I tell you what, it's the energetic of change. We're with this full moon that we just hit in Aries. It's a very powerful time, and things are changing. We are at a very pivotal energetic, and we're dealing with energies that we have not dealt with as a society for hundreds and hundreds of years, some of them in thousands of years. We have Pluto going direct on the 30th, which is next Sunday. And this will be the first time with having Saturn in Capricorn and Pluto in Capricorn since the time of the revolution, like 1760 to 1776, 77, that we have had an energetic like this occur. And, you know, we're feeling things, we're experiencing things, and we're dealing with energies of change that we as a people alive right now haven't dealt with in a long time. And we can change things in a big way. These are the same energetics where 3% of the population, you know, fought against the ultimate deep state, the King George deep state, and won. And nobody believed in them, and very few people supported them. And they all, you know, whenever you say 3% of the population who stood up against King George and the Redcoats and the British, and, came up with the plan of the American Revolution and carried it out, only 3%. That means that they had 97% of the population against them. 97%, dude. I mean, think about that. Going into something, believing in something, and carrying something out when you have 90% of the entire population totally against you. And that's the way it was. And that, these are the same energies we're experiencing now. And there's a fight going on, just the same way there was a fight during those energetic times where the forces of England, the king, the crown, the ultimate deep state, you know, were all behind the power and the glory of the crown, and were totally, you know, dismissive and under attack. The Patriots were under attack. We're in same energetic now. We have the deep state, the established royalty. Because, dude, just like back then when we had the British royalty hanging over, you know, the power over the peoples of the colonies and the Native Americans here also, because they messed with them bad. You had the French and the British royalty messing with the Native Americans and their psyches and the colonists, trying to turn everybody against everybody. You know, that energetic we have going on now, because just the way there were royalty and dukes and governors and all people of level who thought they were parts of society, we have the same thing now in Washington, D.C., with the so-called elite, and still with the royal families and in Britain, and also the banking families, the Rothschilds and all of that nonsense we're dealing with. So, dude, we're facing energetically the same battles. In the same way, though, there was a turn of the tide at one point, and the Patriots, those deplorables of the time, got an advantage and stuck through it with the power. They had literally the heavens on their side. And just now, what the power that you're describing is here available for us again. And we as a people, all of our listeners, if you're listening to me right now, you can decide the direction you want to go. You can decide how this is going to be. And you have the ability to tap into that higher energy of the universe right now and empower yourself and those around you.
Well, absolutely in agreement, but as the naysayer that I am, it is in awe, the game or the situation that the powers that should not be have set up to mess with us on every aspect of our being to make sure that we continue to placate to their games, because they, or the powers that should not be, are not the type of people that are willing just to seclude or to just say, all right, you won, I give up. They will be type that go kicking and screaming and kicking over the board and grabbing their toys and going home.
That's why there's been so much delay and people are getting so frustrated. There is a plan afoot. You know, and followers of QAnon are familiar with the plan. And a lot of people were excited. They had hope. A lot of people are frustrated and very short of patience. People have to realize in battle, and this is battle, people. This is warfare. This is spiritual warfare. This is energetic warfare as much as it is warfare right on the ground. Things change, man. Battlefields are fluid. And because battlefields are fluid, you must constantly have contingency plans. And you must constantly be able to adapt and to bend to the winds of battle. And that's what we're facing right now. Just because you set a plan forward and say, we intend to do this, 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 and this, doesn't mean you can just walk right in, because what you're saying, NeSe, is 100% true. These people, just like the crown, in the 1700s, did not did not in any way, fashion, form that 97% in the colonies wanted to give up their power and comfort and familiarity with the way things were. They were going to fight for it. And they did fight for it. And we see these fights happening right now. And because these fights are ongoing, because these battles are raging, there will be delays. There will be times when you have to go to plan B. And just like any good general never post his plans out there, not only will you not know the primary plan, you may know the gist of it, but you won't know the details. You definitely won't know contingency B, contingency C, and contingency D. I mean, these are battle plans, but things are happening. We're going to talk about some of the dynamics that are happening this evening and what's going on, the Brent Kavanaugh situation. I'm going to bring some up after the break. Avente, the what they call a creepy porn lawyer that was representing Stormy Daniels, and what happened to him. Apparently, it looks like he's been punked really heavy by 4chan, which we're going to call Half Chan, and he was basically tricked and through his story. And there's a lot going on back and forth. Apparently, and I'll read this when we come back on the other side, the Senate's going to be voting for Kavanaugh this Friday. And this is where the big battle is, people. Trump has got to get one more Supreme Court justice on the court to assure that he can do what he's about to do. Because when they start throwing down and arresting people and they start turning this over into military tribunals, it will be challenged at the highest levels, and the highest level is the Supreme Court. And that is why we saw questioning on Kavanaugh during some of the selection committee and the hearings, specifically about martial law and about military tribunals and civilians being tried in military courts. And there's a reason for that. And he supported it 100% and said, yes, it is constitutional, it is legal, because it's going to happen. But none of this stuff, these sealed indictments and all these things that people are saying, it's never going to happen, it's all a LARP, it's all fake. No, it's not. Just be patient, people. They have to get their battle pieces in order. And one of the most important is this appointment to the Supreme Court justice. And that's why they are absolutely losing their freaking minds over this and doing absolutely insane things to try to stop it. Because this is a war, and that is a vital piece of strategy that needs to be in place before all of this can go down. And that's this appointment of Brent Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court. So a lot going on, man, behind the scenes.
Well, you know, it is getting just so combobulated and just such a conundrum that I'm like getting sick and tired of paying attention to it, because I am trying to pay attention to the cycles of nature, the cycle of Mother Earth. And I try not to focus on the cycles of the psychos, because as I've stated many, many times, I don't trust them when they have that much power. And in my experience, in my 51 years, I have never met someone who has had so much money that I would be like, I'd like you to rule or to run things. And that's just my fear, because the cliche is absolute power corrupts absolutely. And I hope and dream and have faith that at some point we as a collective will do what it takes, but at my ability to find the hope or faith that an individual can get it done, I'm unable to find that.
Well, you're 100% correct, because an individual can't. It takes a team. It takes a large team of people who are committed to that, and that's exactly what we see. We are experiencing something. According to the plan, a large group of former military and current military individuals who came together, who actually went to and selected Donald Trump to be president. And that's why this entire thing has come about this way. And it's not about him, and he can't do it alone. This is a large team effort, and it is unbelievable, you know. And that's the thing about the whole QAnon phenomena that people have a hard time with, is because people are more prone to believe and get on board believing that there are alien bases of grays on the backside of the moon that are collaborating with the Nazis who are up there too, who have secret underground bases in Antarctica and fly their UFOs back and forth. And people are like, oh yeah, I can dig that. They will totally accept that. But you tell them there's a group of people that have worked their way into a position of power, and this group of people are working to collectively take down the deep state. They have a plan, and they're moving forward with it. And there are going to be former deep state individuals who go to jail, and people just lose it. They're like, that's preposterous. That's crazy talk. Who in the world would believe such nonsense and craziness? I mean, and it's understandable. It's understandable why people feel that way, because it is so mind-blowing, because we're so aware as a people of how corrupt and ugly and horrible it has begun and it has become. And so it is the first inclination for a person's intuitive nature to say this can't be real. We'll never see this in our lifetime, because it's just too evil to overcome. But you know what? I say good can overcome evil. And if you read the book to the end, God wins. And that's where we're headed right now. Spirit and God and goodness of people will win. Anyway, time is winning right now. We're rolling down to a break here. We're going to be talking about a lot this evening. A lot of current events, a lot of things going on, and reasons why people should have hope. So everybody hang in there. We will be back after these breaks.
And during that break, I will find a lighter so I don't have to quit flicking my bick.
We hear you flicking your bick. We'll be right back, everybody.
You are now tuned into the Truth Frequency.
Your protection from deception.
TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Hello, 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 and hi. Here we are, you and me and everyone else. On September 25th, 2018, the fall equinox, the full moon, Phoenix Rising Radio. All we need now is a nice fireplace, a timbler or a tumbler of a nice, old, well-aged glass of water, and a candy bar cigarette. And we can enjoy even more of the show. How you doing, Phoenix?
I'm doing okay. Thanks for the descriptor. So you're drinking a glass of water and smoking a joint.
I cannot confirm nor deny.
Oh, God. Okay.
But the conclusion would be real.
Yeah, aged water. How old is water? Oh, man. You know, that's an interesting thought. How old is water? It could be new, actually. It could be ancient. There's water trapped in glaciers that they actually break apart and melt and put in bottles. And who knows? But anyway.
Oh, wait, before we jump into something, I want to, since you brought up water. Now, if you notice in the whole Native American community, there's all of these issues of the pipelines that are still continuing. And there's camps all over the country that are trying to prevent pipelines from going through. And I commend them for the movement or the ideology of it is wrong to have all of these oil pipelines crisscrossing and going around boundaries of water. However, when people talk about being water protectors, I agree wholeheartedly about the concept of it. But when these individuals talk about being water protectors and then they go to McDonald's or Burger King's or Perkins and they drink Mountain Dew or Red Bull and then they go and urinate into a toilet, what kind of pollution are they releasing? What kind of water within you are you polluting? And so if you're going to be a water protector, let's do some critical thinking and start protecting the water within you also.
Well, that's an interesting concept and truth, you know, and I would extend that to pharmaceuticals because that's one of the largest polluters of water is pharmaceuticals, residual pharmaceuticals. They were finding that they were having trouble with fish propagating in places, and like, you know, the fish propagation was way down, and they actually traced it to birth control that had been taken by women and excreted through their bodies through their urine, and the residuals of those birth control chemicals that were actually adversely affecting the fish population because the water purification plant would not, I guess, take out all those chemicals that were in pharmaceuticals, and they were ending up in our natural waters, you know, the salmon runways and the rivers and the streams, and was actually causing a downturn in fish propagation. So, yeah, you know, talk about water protection. So if someone's out there talking about water protection or drinking a Red Bull or Mountain Dew and on birth control, they're not doing too good a job protecting water. But yeah,
even with the common American diet that is so horribly against the natural gut bacteria, that it is fact that the majority of people that take tablets, their body's not able to digest them. So it's just passing through with your excrement, and then it goes straight into the water too. I've heard horror stories that in these treatment facilities, these catches and stuff are just filled with pills.
Oh yeah. That's why our sponsor Boomers, their products are all powdered. You know, even the stuff for the probiotic is a powder, and people put it under their tongue, and the actual vitamin supplement comes in powder form, and the barley's in powder form, and you mix it in water. It's extremely soluble, and boom, you drink this stuff, and it's just like totally, it's already totally soluble, and it goes into your system, and you don't have that problem. But yeah. So, you know, the whole thing with protecting of the water, and the Native Americans are out there doing that. You know, the whole problem with running the pipelines across the lands, I don't think that'll ever be resolved until we truly break free of the petrochemicals. And, you know, that's a weird thing, man. Did you know, as well as I do, and most of our listeners know, there is zero reason that we actually need, well, we do now because we're still dependent upon it, but there's zero reason that we are dependent upon anything that's petroleum oriented. And you know that. We don't need it. We, you know, there are alternative technologies that would totally break that, but they have such a system built around that infrastructure, you know, financial system and our infrastructure system, that it's going to take some time to break it. But there will be a time. There will be a time, and it'll either come by hook or by crook, that we will be dependent, I mean, no longer dependent upon that. And I look forward to that day. I hope I see it in my lifetime.
Well, I mean, it's a great segue if I want to go into my favorite topic of all topics, but let's continue on with the craziness that's occurring in politics.
Oh, yeah, that's crazy. All right. Now, the Brent Kavanaugh hearings, which were postponed, well, the final vote for him to be Supreme Court Justice has been deferred and rescheduled for this Friday. So they will be voting, the Senate will be voting on the confirmation of Brett Kavanaugh for Supreme Court Justice this coming Friday. Now, that is after Thursday's hearing with this Professor Ford, the woman who has claimed that she was sexually assaulted by Brent Kavanaugh when he was in high school, which has, she's come forward with four witnesses who were there. All four of these people have signed sworn affidavits, and there have been investigations from Congress, the Senate Judiciary, directly with these individuals and their lawyers, and none of them, including Ms. Ford's best friend, her lifelong friend, said she's never met Brett Kavanaugh, never been anywhere where he was present, and doesn't even know him. So all of her witnesses that she said were there have all, under threat of perjury, criminal perjury, have said, no, this, none of this is true. So there, it's being speculated right now that she will not even appear on Thursday for her hearing, because here's the interesting thing. And Senator Grassley put this out. He sent a letter to Feinstein, because Feinstein again was asking that they delay it. And it's a delay tactic because they want to like push off the confirmation of Kavanaugh. And Senator Grassley would not allow the delay. And he noted in his letter to Senator Feinstein today that it is not a crime for someone to make false allegations and to give false information to a media outlet. He said, but he reminded Senator Feinstein that it is indeed a criminal act if anyone submits knowingly false information and lies to the Senate Judiciary Committee. Then it's a criminal act. So if this woman appears and makes sworn statements and puts forward written documents that is proven to be untrue, and she did it intentionally, either on her own or coerced by someone, they have made note that this will be a criminal act. So I personally do not think she will show up, or if she does, she won't make it into the meeting room or some kind of craziness, because this is a big delay tactic and technique, because the deep state is in a panic. This goes back to what we were talking about, man, about the deep state being taken down. The Q team, Trump and the Q team, can't initiate a full plan until they get that Supreme Court justice spot filled with Kavanaugh or someone of his strength and character. But it looks like it's going to happen. And after Kavanaugh gets in, oh boy, this is when we're going to see a full press on all this declassification, and they're going to drop a hammer on these people. Dude, I know you have a hard time believing it. I mean, you have such a hard time, but I love that, because you're a great example of most people. Again, I refer back to the American Revolution.
That's the most insulting thing you ever said to me.
Oh, sorry, but it's true. It's true.
I'm the furthest thing from most people.
Well, no, I'm saying your view that it's unbelievable that someone could go after the deep state is what I'm saying. I'm not saying overall, you know, that we're all very aware you're an extremely unique individual, NeSe.
No, but I do believe there is a battle. There is a battle of good and evil, but my biggest fear, as I've stated, is that, you know, the greatest tool of battle is distraction. And one of the oldest game plans that the powers that should not be is they create the good guy and the bad guy so they get the result. And that's my fear. Because there are times when I listen to Trump, and forgive me if this is ego, but I feel that because I'm blind, my ears are way tuned in when I listen to things. And there is times when I have listened to Trump speak, and there's times where I'm totally convinced that he's dumb as a box of rocks. And then there's other times when he says stuff where I'm like, okay, is this like another George Bush Jr. where he's just playing dumb?
Yeah, here's what you're getting caught up in. Donald Trump as the individual. Okay, dude, he is just a part. He is the figurehead of this. What's going down? He was selected to hold that position, and the play one side against the other, the good cop, bad cop thing that you said that has always happened, and that is the way they've done it. That was a classic system we had set up with the Republican and Democrats. The very fact that he came in this way and they suspected this was what was going on is why both of those sides, the good cop, bad cop side, let's call it the Clinton cabal, the Bush cabal, the Republicans and Democrats, that's why they lost it, dude. They went off the freaking rails. Dude, you had the Bushes come out and publicly say they were voting for Hillary Clinton.
Right, I get that, and I agree.
This was before he had done anything. They knew he was going to take them all down.
But what about Mike Pence?
What about him? He's a vice president. You've got to have somebody as vice president. But see, dude, he is part of this as his position as vice president, but he is not the president. So
but if there is a,
there's got to be, there's got to be a vice president.
World, if there are demons in this world having intercourse with women, Pence has been the product of, I mean, if you look at this guy's history really deep, this guy I don't think he's a good guy at all.
Here's the other thing you've got to realize and people have to understand. If people are expecting some kind of like messiah or savior or perfect person to step in and do this, it'll never happen because there's no such thing. You know, Donald Trump, does he have faults? Oh, heck yeah. We all do. And see, that's one reason a lot of people have trouble with him, because he's not like, you know, a preacher or something, you know, like how can he be doing this if he's not like, you know, like some super godly man? Well, that's just the way he is, man. God uses everyone. God can use anyone. Saul, who turned into Paul, used to go out and kill Christians. That was his thing. He would go from city to city seeking out Christian groups, and he was like in charge of teams that would go around, persecute, capture these guys and kill them. That's what he did. That's when his name was Saul. And then he had, you know, his encounter, and he became Paul. And so how many people who knew, I mean, I can see people right now saying, oh, my God, do you know who this guy Paul is? He's Saul. Do you know what he did and what he does to people? I mean, the guy was horrible. Paul the Apostle, before he became Paul the Apostle, was a horrible person. I mean, he murdered people, man. He was bad. He was no good. But God used him. And see, that's the thing. This thing is not going to change by a personality. And the distraction of Donald Trump, and all about Donald Trump, is exactly that. It's a huge distraction, and he doesn't care. He's got the ability and the type of personality that he could do this. He didn't need to do this, man. Most people who run for president want the power and the money. He didn't need either one, man. The guy had it made in the shade. He and his whole family, he did not need to subject himself to this, and he gets no money for it. He gives it all away. I mean, this is doing him more harm than good. But he did it because he loves his country, and he was asked and persuaded by a group of people who were working, call them the White Hats. You know, I guess that would be the term to call these guys, the White Hats. And, you know, again, here we spin off into an area that is so unbelievable for people. You know, Bigfoot riding a unicorn across the flat earth is more acceptable to most people, you know, than to say there are White Hats that are actively going after the deep state and it's actually happening. And then you get into the aspect of the QAnon and the Q drops, where the psychology of this and the PsyOps of this are where they're putting this information out to the public in advance. People just come off the rails like this is too good to be true. This can't be real. So it's understandable. Now, here's the thing. Future proves past. Q says that all the time. Future proves past. We are going to see a situation here that's going to start proving this stuff out. One of them to watch for, everyone, and we talked about this the other night, and they say, is you are going to see at some point Attorney General Jeff Sessions stand up and say he is going to unrecuse himself, and he did so under the counsel and advice of the Supreme Court, and he's going to unrecuse himself. Watch for that one to happen, because that will happen.
Yeah, that, I mean, it's I'll believe it when I see it.
I know.
If and when it happens, then it's going to be one step towards where one has made a prediction.
You know? It's more than a prediction. It's this is basically what he said, what Q said. It was like, what, over a week ago. He said that Sessions had sent a secret letter and been in correspondence with the Supreme Court about his unrecusal, and it had been approved. And so that information alone was advanced information from Q, and we've gotten it before in different ways, sometimes a week in advance, sometimes months in advance. But this stuff takes time to play out. And again, the reason it's taking so long is, again, back to this Kavanaugh thing. He has got to get that Supreme Court justice seat filled firmly before they cut loose on all this. And dude, whenever Kavanaugh, when we see the Supreme Court justice seat filled by Kavanaugh and he's confirmed, everybody buckle up, because it is going to hit the freaking fan, dude.
Well, would you then conclude that if this other judge stepped down, wouldn't it be logical to conclude that he was coerced or threatened to step down? Because the judge that Kavanaugh is replacing now.
Oh no, no one's stepping down. Someone's retiring. He's retiring, and Kavanaugh's taking his place. Yes.
Okay, so if this is what Trump's team needed, the people behind Trump, if they needed this Supreme Court judge position to be filled in order for these things to occur, then that would logically conclude that they pressured this judge to step down, to retire.
Now, actually, he was very old and his health isn't that great, and he's retiring because he felt comfortable to retire after Trump was in office, because he knew that Trump would choose a pro-constitutionalist like he was basically the story that's been relayed by this gentleman. He's old. He wants to retire. He's been there many decades.
Right, but it's very convenient for this cabal group that's trying to get rid of the supposedly powers that shouldn't be right now.
Yeah, I wouldn't call them a cabal. I would call them White Hats, group of White Hats.
Potato, potato.
Potato, potato. Yeah, it is a strong it is a strong group. And he has a military behind him. Yes, he does. But yeah, they just needed someone young, strong, and believes the way that they believe that they could trust in that position. So they had to get that seat filled, because this isn't going to be overnight. When these military tribunals begin and all of this start, it's going to take some time to work through all this. It's not going to be like, boom, there it is, a week later, it's over. This is going to go on for many months and years as the people are being processed and the entire thing rolls out, because there will potentially be civil unrest. There'll be problems because they're going to pull out all the freaking stops, dude. I don't know. Well, no, I know you didn't because of your inability to see, but some of the protests at the Kavanaugh hearings were just off the rails. And the things they're saying and doing are just insane. I mean, you have Democratic lawmakers standing up, people who make laws, who are attorneys, saying that, you know, Kavanaugh has no right to be assumed innocent. You know, the basic premise of our judicial system of you are innocent until proven guilty. They are actually standing up and saying, "Oh no, he's guilty," without hearing anybody. I mean, this is insane, dude. They have lost it. They've gone totally off the rails.
This is a great segue to go into this. As you were stating in the beginning with the whole mocking term, that there are these buzzwords that are popping up that people are grabbing like it's billion-dollar bitcoins, and they're using them in any kind of defense. And if I may placate to some of them, like on a social media network, if you disagree with somebody, right off the bat, you are either labeled a hater. You can't get more polar than that, than you're a friend or acquaintances or family on somebody's social network, and they clicked on you, so they accepted you as one of their friends. And then because you disagree, one of the comebacks they come with is you're just a hater because you don't agree with that. And then the next one is, oh, you're just a troll. Well, then if they're a troll and you're on your fake book, aren't they not there because you clicked on it?
Oh, I know. You know, dude, I know that is exactly what we're talking about with the psychological manipulation. They have been so successful at doing this. It's insane. It's to watch it. And to see how it plays out is incredible. And yeah, there's very blatant displays of this. But when we come back from the break, we're going to talk about some of the subtle things. And I think I'm going to get into some of the signs that people can look at within yourselves to see if you're actually being manipulated and you're a victim of psychological operations, PsyOps. Because everybody's talking PsyOps without really knowing how it works. I mean, it's more subtle and more prevalent than people realize. And all of us are immersed in it. So, but you don't have to be a victim of it. It's like if you don't know how to swim, you know, you can be a victim of water. Throw you in a pond, and if you don't know how to swim, you got a problem. You know, you can be a victim of water. But if you know how to swim, and you've successfully learned that, and you don't panic, it's not a problem. It's like, hey, thanks for throwing me in the water. I was getting a little hot. You can float on your back. You can swim around. You can enjoy it. So if you can learn how to identify it, navigate in it, become comfortable with it, and use it to your advantage, you won't be harmed by it. But it will be around there. You will get wet from it because, man, it's everywhere. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. And I think some people will be surprised about how subtle these things are.
Well, you may not be a full-on victim of it, but you will be affected of it if you are not aware.
True.
Time. The illusion. That's the one thing that is totally keeping us within the cell.
Mm-hmm.
So pay attention to that time and come back after that short break of time.
Yeah. Time. Patience. You know, the inability to stand the test of time. Frustrating for people. But anyway, we'll be right back. Don't go away.
Truth Frequency Radio is your number one.
You are now tuned into the Truth Frequency.
We are TFR. TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome to Phoenix Rising Radio. Now is the time to lift your mind higher. Now is the time to rise above. I am your host, Phoenix, and welcome to tonight's broadcast.
Yes, the storm is upon us. The storm is here, and it is going to get pretty interesting. You know what? Because of that, you need to be the best that you can be. So I would encourage you to go to truthiswellness.com, truthiswellness.com, and check out the products that you can access there of Boomers Forever Young. Fantastic. We were talking about water purity and caring about water and how pills don't do so well with people and passes right through your systems. Boomers Boost is a different type of product. It's powder and it's totally soluble, and you can really, really feel the difference. Is it cheap? No, it is not cheap, but it's good. It's just like the old adage, you get what you pay for, is really, really good stuff. And you can be the best that you can be so you can weather this storm and be strong in this storm. Anyway, that's truthiswellness.com. We're talking about all kinds of things. Before we went to the break, we were touching upon psychological operations in the media, in all forms of media. That's what we're going to talk a little bit about right now. You know what, though? NeSe, I want to bring up something that happened of Michael Avente, who was Stormy Daniels' lawyer. They call him the creepy porn lawyer. He looks like he got punked by 4chan. Apparently, someone over on 4chan, on that Avente, is saying it's not true. But apparently, a guy said that he and his girlfriend punked Avente, and this information that Avente saying that he has this horrible information on Kavanaugh about all these sexual exploits and stuff, it was basically a setup. A guy and his girlfriend with a burner phone, the girl called up Avente and claimed that she went to school with Kavanaugh and said she was a stripper and that he and his friend did all these horrible things and set up sex trains and stuff on her and other girls, and then claimed that she had someone that could confirm the story and gave him the phone number to another burner phone of her boyfriend who set this whole punk up. And he claimed to be a classmate of Kavanaugh's. I'm like, oh yeah, I knew him and tried and was confirming this whole thing. And then it got really crazy. He said Avente was just like freaking out, just like the wheels were turning. And he ended up calling the guy's girlfriend like 20 times and offering her all kinds of money to, you know, go on CNN and do these interviews. And they ended up just like she got scared and stopped. But they made the claims today that all of it was fake. Now, here's the problem with Avente coming out and saying all these crazy things. He made accusations against a sitting judge. Kavanaugh was a currently sitting judge on a circuit court. This guy has been a federal judge for years. And this attorney, Kavanaugh, came out and claimed that this judge, this federal judge, was guilty of sexual crimes and all these horrible things and rape and all this stuff. Dude, if Avente cannot prove that, this guy's in serious trouble because he's an attorney and he will be cited for making serious character assassination against a sitting federal judge. So Avente is probably sweating bullets tonight.
Yeah, it's rather interesting when you go and look at the letter of the law, because when you go to the letter of the law, there is no distinction of gray. You know, that's why I always suggest that if you are going to court, you proclaim your writ of habeas corpus and you make sure that you have a jury of your peers making a decision of your future and not just one individual.
Yeah, because I tell you what, the powers they have over all of that is incredible, and people don't realize. Now, let me see. I have it here. Hold on. Let me grab this stuff about Avente so people know. I'm going to go run over to 4chan real quick. We'll call Half Chan. If you're, thread archived, can't reply anymore. Okay.
Now, if everybody remembers, this is the lawyer that was stepping up with the Stormy allegations. And yeah. If I'm correct, right?
That is correct. They call him the creepy porn lawyer. And, oh, by the way, if people are wondering what happened with that, well, because of the mainstream media, they're only anti-Trump and anything negative. You did not hear that that was all dropped. A judge threw it all out. That went before the judge, and the judge was like, absolutely not, and threw it all out. It's actually a liberal judge who did that. That's why you don't hear about the Stormy Daniels case anymore, because it's not a case. But you're not going to hear that on CNN or MSNBC or any of that, because that doesn't fit their agenda. So, but he's still around. Now, what he did, and here is the post from the guy on 4chan. He says, how to F with a porn lawyer. And, of course, this is an anon over on 4chan. He says, gather in, fags, it's story time. He goes, okay, have stripper girlfriend give him a call on her burner phone. She tells him that she is a 51-year alumni of a private Holton Arms school and that Brett Kavanaugh and his buddy Mark Judge ran a train on her. Tells him that she knows all the secret codes, find them, feel them, French them, F them, and forget them. And Devil's Triangle is a three-way, F them, blah, blah, blah. And anyway, he eats it all up. I have to retract some of the words because we're on the radio. She has him call my burner phone, cell phone. And he says, I am a classmate of Judge Kavanaugh to confirm. He says, in my creepiest deep throat voice, I can confirm it all. He says, then he can hear Avante's wheels spinning. He's thinking he's broken the story of the year. Then it says, calls girlfriend 10 times, wants her to tell her story on Anderson Cooper 360. She cries that she cannot be around men. He then begs her to do a one-on-one special with Poppy Harlow. She would, but her car just broke down and the rent is due. She cannot miss work. So Avente offers her $20,000. She cries that she cannot because she'll lose her job. $20,000 isn't enough. So he ups it to $75,000 and much more after the GoFundMe goes through, the GoFundMe scam. She'll be a national hero, he tells her. She agrees. Claims the money will be wired in 2 hours. Right after that, right after she signs a CNN exclusive, she agrees to this. He says, then the phone doesn't stop ringing. And she tells me she's bored and scared about it and she wants to stop. He says, okay, I've had enough fun with this, jack off. He says, then we break our burner phones. And then Avanti disables his Twitter. And that's basically what happened. Avanti disables Twitter. He's claiming that this isn't true, that that none of this is true. But again, he disabled his Twitter and he's gone silent on all this because it looks like there's a strong possibility this Avanti guy was scammed. He was punked. And again, the problem with this, NeSe, and everybody listening, Avanti being a lawyer, if this is true and he's been punked and he doesn't have the evidence, he publicly on TV, and also he contacted the Senate Judiciary Committee making claims that a sitting federal judge is a rapist and did all these horrible things. Dude, if he can't come up and prove what he has said, this Avanti guy is in big, big trouble. The very least of his troubles, he'll probably be disbarred. But on top of that, he could be seriously sued, man.
Have you ever heard, and I'm trying to recall from my data banks, that, oh no, I just revealed that I am a robot. Dang it.
We knew this.
Anyway, do you recall coming across any information that you cannot be a judge unless you are a Masonic Lodge participant?
You know what? I never have, because I've listened to a lot of the talk about that. I know, back in the day, there was all this talk and education going on about the judicial system and about the bar association, what
British
it really means.
Accredited registry.
Exactly. British accredited registry. And about being a, what do they call it? Esquire and what that all means. You know, there was a reason why, who was it? You might be able to remember this. Somebody in our early stages as a nation actually wanted to make it illegal for anyone who was a lawyer, a member of the bar, to actually hold office in the U.S. Remember that?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, now that I am dealing with court matters right now, and hopefully at someday I can share with the audience of what I'm going through, but I am representing myself, and I love the cliche of a man that represents himself in court has a fool for a lawyer, because as I research more and more and I start learning about constitutional law, it is amazing to realize how we as a collective of citizens within the confines of the United States totally give up our rights. We are absolutely complacent to the powers that shouldn't be chipping away our rights. And there are challenges with the Constitution. However, it is something that we can all at least agree on. And if we break apart that Constitution, it will put us in a worse state of affairs. And if you follow the history of law and those that participated in it, there are many, many occurrences of statutes and regulations that were brought about that should have not, and they still to this day violate our constitutional rights.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. Now, here's something I want to point out while we're talking about this, because I've seen a lot of discussion and a lot of people get behind, you know, this concept. And again, this is a form of PsyOps, of a constitutional convention. A con-con is the slang for it, a con-con, constitutional convention. And there's this big push. People want a constitutional convention. And the theory is, and what people will say is like, oh, we're doing this so we can protect our rights and we need to go in. Now, what a constitutional convention is you have to have the states come together, and you have to have so many of them vote on this to convene one. And there's a big push right now to get states to vote on this. And everyone would come together, and you would basically rewrite the Constitution or, you know, change it. This is a dangerous thing. Our Constitution's fine. Yes, there are some things that shouldn't be in there, maybe. But if you open the door up, especially under this political climate and the skullduggery that's going on to alter our Constitution, the result may not be what you want it to be. It's a truly a case of be careful what you wish for, because right now what we need to do is preserve what we have. The problem is not that the Constitution needs to be changed. The problem is that we need to have judges that follow the Constitution. And that's one thing that Trump is doing. He is, I forget the number of judges, NeSe. It's like almost 200 judges that they put in. And they're closely looking for people to follow the Constitution, because that's his one benchmark. And he says that publicly. He says, we need judges who support the Constitution and not who interpret and write their own law. That's got to stop, because what happens is you have people in positions of judgeships, and they go in and they interpret the Constitution the way they would like to see it. And basically they write their own law and change stuff. And that is so dangerous. That's why we really have to be careful who's on the Supreme Court, who's in federal judge positions, these appellate courts, and all of this. It's very, very important. So what we need is to abide by and follow the Constitution. We need, you know, less laws, not more laws.
Well, I strongly suggest that every individual take some time, and whether it's just chipping away at it in a slow pace, but to go through not only their cities' statutes, but their counties and their states and the United States Constitution, because they did not go through it enough when we're in school. And to me, it makes absolute sense why they would not go through it to such an extent, because had we been more educated about our rights, we would be absolutely rioting in the streets. And the biggest challenge that I've always had with the whole position of president is executive orders. You can have nightmares if you go back and you go and read through these historical executive orders. And Obama, and I wish I could remember off the top of my head, but Obama signed in an executive order, and I wish I can remember the number. But it basically equated that under martial law, that even if you are a survivalist or a preparer, that according to law, because you reside within the United States, they have the right to come and take everything you have and bring it mm-hmm. to a distribution center.
Yeah.
And pass out your mm-hmm. stores.
Oh, yeah, that is true. That was one of his big National Defense Authorization Acts. Had a lot of that stuff in it, like martial law stuff and that ability. But that even goes back further than him. The Bushes and the Clintons, and they have been chipping away at that for years. And that is a very dangerous thing. His NDAA that he signed, there was actually a congresswoman down in Texas who put a warning out to everybody when all this was going down, because he basically laid out forced labor where you would have to go. The gist of it was during a declared emergency, the government would seize everything. They would seize all farms, all farm production, all farm equipment. I mean, this is very Stalin-esque, just like Stalin did. All factory production. They would take over all of that, all grocery stores, all pharmacies, and they would be in total control of all food production, food distribution, and pharmaceutical production and distribution. And the aspect that you were talking about where they would be able to come in if you had in excess of like 3 days of food or something and deem it, you know, possession of the people and take it in. Yeah, that was all in place. I mean, extremely draconian. And not only that, he had it set up in that when you read it, that you would have to register at the United States Post Office and they would be able to separate you from your family and assign you to work projects. Dude, just like Stalin did. And this woman put a warning out in Texas. I mean, to all of her constituents, she said, this is the most dangerous thing I've ever seen. And, of course, it didn't get covered on the news because he got a free pass from the all of that. This started many decades ago, and it's gone through multiple administrations. It wasn't just Obama. Wasn't just Bush. Clinton started it wholeheartedly. They really got it pushed. And they started with the entire Marxist thing and the slow turnover of this government. They were, dude, you know how close we were to totally losing our Constitution? If Hillary Clinton would have become president of the United States, I don't know what position we'd be in right now, because she was going to go after the Constitution. She was going to put Loretta Lynch in on the Supreme Court. Ruth Bader Ginsburg was going to resign, and she had all these corrupt people in all these positions. Dude, they were going to take this country apart. We wouldn't have the Second Amendment. We wouldn't have the First Amendment. They were going to go after the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, and basically, because they were teaching in school that the Constitution is just an old piece of paper that was written by a bunch of old white guys who had slaves. That's how they teach the Constitution in schools now. It's an old, antiquated, outdated document written by white men who had slaves. I kid you not. That's what they tell kids.
Oh, I remember that. And then I remember Bush Jr. in his famous vocal faux pas when he called it a GD piece of paper.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, yeah,
they've let this slip before. And again, this is not a Republican Democrat issue. This was a total corruption. The Democratic and Republican Party totally comped, dude, totally corrupted a lot of people, but they're still good people. And that's what we're seeing right now. This is what this unbelievable aspect that's going on behind the scenes that I believe in wholeheartedly. And, future proves past. I hope that we are able to celebrate the realities of this right here on Phoenix Rising Radio in the future. Again, markers to look for, everyone. Watch for the Supreme Court nominee Kavanaugh to be voted on and accepted in the Supreme Court, because I think that's going to be the big marker that's going to kick this stuff off. And look the heck out, man. We're going to see Sessions recuse himself. We're going to see some of these things that have been going on in the background that nobody has seen or had access to, that Sessions has been doing. Huber, the special prosecutor that he assigned out in Utah, has been doing. And everything that's been going on behind the scenes, we're going to start seeing this stuff made public. And especially when they declassify all of these FISA documents and these text messages, dude, it is rumored that in the text messages between Comey, who was director of FBI, McCabe, who was assistant director, Bruce Orr, Nellie Orr, Page, and Strzok, it's rumored, and Q had alluded to this back in February, that there were discussions about the actual assassination of the president of the United States and his family amongst the high levels of our government.
Well, that that scenario does not surprise me at all. And again, I bring up Mike Pence.
Yeah, no, not that's not Mike Pence wouldn't be behind that. This was deeper. Mike Pence is a white hat dude. He's not, you know, that's the disinformation that Pence is a bad guy that wants to see Trump outed. Not true. That is not true. As a matter of fact, Sessions just let slip. I read something the other day, somebody whose father's highly connected, and he was at an event where Sessions was at. It was like an intimate event with a small group of people, maybe 50, 60 people. And Jeff Sessions, and this was last week, he told everyone there. He said, I just want to tell everybody. He said, all this stuff, this perceived feud between the president and I, he goes, it's not real. He goes, it's fake. He goes, that's just for the media and public consumption. He goes, we're working really tight together. And that confirms what Q has been saying, you know, trust Sessions. Dude, I really do. I think, you know, have hope, not just you, but everyone, that this is going to turn around. You know, now you were talking, and we'll talk more about the energetics of this when we come back from break. You were talking about this is the perfect time energetically to set a new course. I'm telling you, it really is. And it's important for all of us to stay positive and to back away from the negative. So we're going to talk a little bit about those positive energies and also the influence of the Mockingbird media on us, and how you can tell if you're being influenced. We'll cover all these on our last segment when we return from the break.
And you know how you can tell when we're the good guys, Phoenix?
How's that, NeSe?
Is when you do come back from the break.
When I do come back from the break. And we'll hopefully be here. I will. Yeah. Hey, we got like 20 seconds before. How cold is it there yet?
OMG. I'm literally, I tried to wait until October before I turn on my heater, but today I had to replace the filter.
Wow.
And it's supposed to get down to 40s tonight. Wow.
We'll be right back, everyone.
But I'm warm at heart.
Real people, real radio.
Initiating the Truth Frequency.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
What is going down? What is going up? What is going to the left? What's going to the right? What's behind? And are you moving forward, or are you stopping where you are here with NeSe and Phoenix on Phoenix Rising Radio, making our proclamation of 0 point so we can set a course for a positive direction?
100% agree. A positive direction. And this is what you're tasked with. This is your assignment, if you choose to accept it, to envision how you want to be, how you want things to be, who you are. And see, that's the problem, dude, with social media. People don't know who they are. People are always trying to reconfirm and rebuild who they are. And it's difficult in today's world because of the media onslaught. Things are no longer simple. The flooding of information, of ideas, and everyone has an opinion about everything and everybody else. And people are trying to fit in. You know, to the psychological aspects of manipulation, people who are triggered by this and who are, now you say, not victims, but highly influenced. And you can become a victim of this if you allow yourself to be highly influenced. People will be influenced to the point where they'll pick up ideas and buzzwords and do things that are totally opposite of what they're saying. That's one way to see someone who's been triggered, or if you have been. I mean, like, if you're screaming at someone, telling them to shut up, and you say you stand for free speech, well, that's not too free for speech. You know, if you say that you stand up for freedoms and people's rights, but you have physically attack other people or verbally attack other people to make them agree with the way you do, then you're violating their rights. So by saying that you support people's rights, if you actively go against other people's rights, that's totally opposite of what you're saying. And that's one indication. But personally, as individuals, if you see something or hear something and it invokes within you a strong, real quick emotional response, then you've been triggered. And you have to ask yourself why. Why did you, with such a speed and strength, get emotionally triggered? Now, this is a subtle thing you have to look for, because we all have emotions and we all have things we like, we have things we dislike, and that's just the natural state of things. But if you have an adverse reaction to someone's statement or something you read or something you see or hear, and it's over the top, it's not just you like, ooh, you know, I really disagree with that. If it causes an emotional response in you that actually gets you physically agitated or to the point of anger or wanting to act out, you're being played. That is a classic sign of falling prey to psychological things. And also, you'll see people that will take stances on things and become extremely anti-fill-in-the-blank. Just fill-in-the-blank, anti-whatever, and they almost become militant. And they become what's known as social justice warriors, who are... They feel like they are tasked to correct everyone and to set the record straight wherever they go, and they do it with great force and sometimes violence. Dude, that is classic psychological manipulation, and we're seeing it all over.
You know, it is unfortunate that sometimes, I think it's Michael Talbot in his Universal... Oh, no, I just lost the title of the name, but it's Michael Talbot's the author. But in it, he talks about how sometimes our worst enemy is the closest people to us, because sometimes people are so fearful to be honest with you for the fear of losing your friendship that they won't be honest with you. And it is unfortunate when we have individuals that sometimes are going off reservation or going off the rails, you know, and we have to really critically ponder, how do I bring this person back? Because, as Phoenix is talking about emotion, I believe with what is absolutely going on with the cycle right now, not just on the microcosm, but the macrocosm, with the whole shifting of the lunar month cycle, where it's 29 and a half days still from full moon to full moon. And also right now, as I was declaring earlier, that the equinox is today, again, the 25th, where there has been over a 14-day shift in the great cycle of the Earth. And I really, really wish that I would have last solstice, put up a sundial. And I was actually looking into getting a sundial and trying to get a camera, a year-long camera that would just shine down on the sundial without interrupting the shadow so it can track it. Because it is crazy on all levels. And unfortunately, maybe it's always been crazy, but we just haven't noticed it as much as we're noticing it today.
Actually, I think what it is an energetic, you know, I believe in it. We talk about astrology a lot. The influences of the planets. This is a larger cycle. Like I've been telling everyone, this is the energetic of during the Revolutionary War time, you know, from 1760, 1776, 77, all in that energetic. And we're seeing repeat of that, but there's even larger energies. You heard me say the other night, there was a time, and you know this very well, we've talked about calendars, that the length of the year was 360 days. That's where we get 360 degrees on our you know, compass, 360 degrees of a division of a circle. 1 year was 360 days. And it was noted and seen in ancient calendars all over the world that had been discovered. But something happened. Something happened. And all within like a 5-year period, as far as researchers can tell, everybody, every culture changed their calendar. And they changed it in different ways. And that's why there's so much contested about these calendar changes and why and how they happened. But what happened was there was an additional 5 days that all of a sudden over a 5-year period, the Earth, the 1 year period went from 360 days a year to 365 days a year. And it's not even exactly that. I mean, they have to do the leap year and all that. And what happened was all around the world, they find historically that these calendar changes happen. And there were some references in ancient history in China and the Bible, particularly about the day where the sun stood still. And the day was extra long for this battle. It was a miracle of God. And at the same time, it was recorded in China where the sun actually set and then reappeared. It set in the west and rose in the west and stayed there for a while and then set in the west again. But in the Middle East, where this other miracle at the same time happened, of course, the sun just stood still in the daylight. I'm sure it moved some in the sky, but it just appeared as daylight, so it was a longer day. And they're saying that what happened was there was some large astrological body in the solar that entered our solar system that interfered with our rotation and the gravitational pull. And that's what changed it. And there is a high degree of probability that we're seeing something like that again, NeSe, with the shifting of the poles, the changing of these equinox cycles, and the strangeness that we're seeing. It's very subtle, just like I'm sure it was subtle when they first observed this back many centuries ago. But it comes to a point where it's more than not so subtle. It's almost like a catastrophic thing that could happen and really change things. So, you know, there's some biblical prophecies in the book of Revelation where it talks about I think it's the shortening of the days, where the day and the night would shine, the sun would shine one third less and the sun would be one third less, which means basically what would happen would be the rotation of the earth would speed up. Right.
So or if you slow down. Yeah.
Well, no, it would speed up because if you had a one third less daylight, that means the earth rotates quicker from dark to dark. And if you had one third less nighttime, the same thing. So we're talking about a prophetic observation that could actually mean the increased rotation of the earth in speed. Well, now, what that would do, I have no idea.
The celestial body that you discuss, you know, depending on the trajectory and the angle that it comes by and the closeness of it, because if it passes by us in the opposite direction of our spin, you know, then that's going to have major effect on it too. And even the gravitational aspect of it, because this is one thing that's being measured with all the other celestial bodies right now, that there is a strange mass change or a mass gravitational, for lack of a better term, magnetic would probably be better to denote it, but there's a change that's occurring to all of these celestial bodies. And with the aspect of all of the planets being going into retrograde at one point, and you know, when all of these spheres are on the other side of the sun, it creates a gravitational or electromagnetic pull or push. And it is a delicate dance, all of these planets with each other, and as above, so below. When it comes down to it, it's all electromagnetic fields, and so are we. Mm-hmm. You know, so when we are happy, we tend to vibrate higher. When we're sad, we tend to vibrate lower. But when you know where your vibrational field is, this is when you have the opportunity to denote your zero point and make the attempt, make the effort, make the action to attain that power and bring yourself out of that funk. And if worse comes mm-hmm. to worst, you always got rubber rabbit.
Rubber rabbit, you got it. You know, it's so true, though. In the midst of all this, we've talked about a lot of things this evening, political chaos, things that are happening, new territories we've never experienced as human beings. And we don't know. We have prophetic insights and things that were written ages ago that we can reference. And one thing that we can do is to find that higher vibrational point and be positive, because if everything goes off the rails, I mean, we're talking about the plan with Q, the white hats and all that, that's plan. You know, there's man proposes, God disposes. You know, how many plans have fallen off the rails? Because if we do have something that were to cause these effects, which have happened in the past, all the plans go out the window. And we could get into a situation where, kind of goes kind of tribal, man. And in that situation, you have to be able to be as self-sufficient and happy as you can be. And I know that sounds crazy to say be happy, but you've got to be. And this is the ultimate survival skill, is your mindset to overcome adversity and to tap back into what really makes us human. And that's community. That's community. And, helping one another on a community level. And things can get in perspective real quick under something like that.
Well, this is the opportunity that I take when I do my rituals or my ceremonies, you know, with accordance of the cycles and my ancestors, where I will be starting my fast. And then when I break my fast, I'll be having a feast. But then when we have a feast, we'll be opening up to my neighbors and to my family and my friends. And, you know, and it's a great opportunity to network, you know, because that's the real social media, is when you go and knock on your neighbor's door and you say, hi, this is who I am, you know, and let us break bread together. Because if the proverbial fan gets struck, that's who you're going to need to depend on. And if you don't know your neighbors and they don't know you, how can you have any trust?
True. Yeah, these things are self-correcting really quick. But also there's a the psychological phenomena of the 3-day period I've talked about, where you have those who are leaning towards the best of humanity in themselves rise to the occasion for themselves and those around them, but those who vibrate to the lowest of their ability lower themselves to the occasion to those around them. And you will see a sharp division and a pulling away of false pretenses and psyches. And that's can be a very good and positive thing, or it can be a very shocking and negative thing. And people have to be prepared for that too, because it's not all sunshine and roses and fuzzy little bunnies. You know, that's just not the reality of it, because we all have different levels of moral value, of different levels of what we aspire to. And it's you know, I don't want to say society's gotten worse, because you've always had a bad aspect to it. But you always have the light and the dark. That's just the reality of the way things are. And we have to be aware of this and not be so, you know, have your heads in the sand, spiritual sand, because that's a blindness in itself, man. There's like a false sense of spirituality that people get into. You know, like, oh, I'm vibrating above it all, and we're, you know, no, you know, it's that's not the way of the existence that we roll in this energetic soup. There is a difference, and we have to be aware of that.
Well, you know, I'm getting really frustrated with all of the exercising I have to do lately.
Really?
Because I'm just not a fan of demons. And so it seems more times than not, I'm exercising all the time.
That's where you meant.
It's no fun casting out demons. I'd rather everybody just do it themselves. It's not that difficult.
Yeah, well, here's the key to that is shielding, not casting out. You get to the point of casting out, you're on the hard side of it. The way to do it is to keep yourself shielded. And the way to keep yourself shielded is through prayer. Prayer. People have to pray. And, you know, pray for one another. Pray for yourselves. You know, pray before your feet hit the floor in the morning. And I don't care if you believe in prayer or not. Even if you don't believe, pray. Try it. When was the last time you prayed? When was the last time you said a prayer for yourself, for your family, for your loved ones?
And even if you're thinking of being agnostic or atheist, then let's get it away from the semantics of thing and just talk about intentions. You know, if you don't want to call it prayer, then have intentions, make proclamations, whether you say them inside you or outside of you. They are still an energy. The minute that you think it, an electromagnetic occurrence happened in your brain and you created a spark, for a lack of a better term. And the more sparks you create that are the same focus, it is like the 5-watt light bulb, where it's not too great, thank you, Ken Wilder, but it's like the 5-watt laser, where you focus when you meditate. Meditating isn't about clearing your mind. It's about focusing your mind, finding focus on what that you are meditating on. And when you get that focus, that is when you can plot your course or get your direction. However, where I talk about the whole exercising of demons, unfortunately, I have met individuals that like to expand their consciousness with the use of plant medicines. And I'm not opposed to it at all if you are consciously aware and ready and responsible enough to do such things. Because when you open these portals, things can go in and things can go out. And so you must be very, very careful if you are going to do such things. And you can open portals just by sitting there meditating and praying, also not with just plant medicines, even with alcohol, even with sugar. Any substance you put in your entity can affect a portal opening.
True. And back to the point of this and all of this, you know, tonight we've talked about a lot of things. I was talking about the psychological influences of media, all forms of media, even alternative media upon you. If you hear one thing or another, then it evokes a strong response within you. Stop and ask, why are you being toyed with? Think for yourself. Don't let anyone tell you what to believe. Anyone, one way or the other. Prove it out yourself. But keep your intent focused, like NeSe was just saying, on goodness. And now is the time to change things. Now is the time to set your course in this new energetic that we're entering right now, that with great intensity we're going to be rolling into as the 2020s come into this. It's very important. Just let go of the past. Make peace with it. Be very conscious of your energetic, what you're projecting, and what you're allowing into your mind and your heart. Be very careful of this. Then you don't have to exercise. Things are repelled. But this is a conscious effort you're going to have to make through prayer, through meditation. And I really hope that everyone does that. It's so, so important.
Well, I talk about the Holy Trinity of positive, negative, and neutral. And if you can't be in the positive, then at least just be neutral. Because at least being neutral is still helping keeping it towards a positive state, and it's not adding to the negativity. Because we all know what right and wrong is.
Yeah, and you can't be used. You can't be used by forces that would harness into your energy, your voice, your physical being, carry signs around, break windows or whatever, scream, spit on people, chase people out of restaurants, or wear funny hats out in public. You won't be influenced by stuff like that. You know, you want to stay strong and true to yourself. Don't be a victim of groupthink. If you are tempted to grab a sign and get on a bus and be with a large group of people and make chants that you've been told exactly what to say, you might want to rethink that. Because is that truly what you want to do with your time? I mean, are you that hungry for social interaction that you would digress to such behavior? Think about it. Anyway, we got like a minute. We're rolling out of here. We'll be back on Thursday. Let me see. Do I have any guests? I think Bob Gilpatrick may be joining me on Thursday. Really not sure. I'll have to check the schedule there. But everybody can check over at goingglobaleastmeetswest.blogspot.com. NeSe, thank you for joining me tonight, sir. And this is much appreciated.
Thank you. You can check out my stuff at The Megaphone Man on YouTube or Cannabis Res Solution. And thank you again, Phoenix, for this next phase as we go into the darkness of winter in the northern, actually the southern hemisphere. But since they taught us it was the northern, we'll just agree to that. In space, where is up and down? Be here.
You got it. Anyway, yeah, everyone stay warm. Cold, cold winter coming here in the northern hemisphere. And we'll talk more about that. Again, we're going to really make a topic of this modern minimum, solar minimum we're entering. That's it, though. We're out of here right now. Thanks again, NeSe. Thanks, everybody, for listening this evening. And be sure and join us on Thursday. Till then, find someone you love. Tell them you love them. Good night.
Toodles.